First of all, thank you to joining us for this special talk, and I am sure that you people will get benefit, number of the benefits from this talk, because today we have a very special and very renowned personality in the specific area of the copy editing. Let me introduce one more thing about our publication, so that I have to share my screen. Because today we are here because of the Chitkara University Publications. And Chitkara University Publications basically is a diamond open access journal. We are publishing here since 2013. Why we are celebrating actually these events? Yesterday you have observed, and tomorrow we will also conduct one more event. So this is the peer review week, and all these things are just for the awareness to the research scientific community. And the theme of this peer review week is the identity in peer review. So identity basically carry in a different perspective, that may be the social identity and cultural identity, geography, and different point of view we can define the identity. So Chitkara University Publication actually is an open access initiative of the Chitkara University. And today I am just, I will moderate this presentation. Earlier we had celebrated many more things related to the same. I am the member of this and cross-rep ambassador in India. And this one day national seminar discussion about to the plagiarism and many poor things with the librarians. And yesterday it was a panel discussion about to the identity in peer review, where we had discussed many more points. And the most important point is about to the Chitkara University Publication is that we are publishing 9 diamond open access journals. So if you are not aware about what is the meaning of the diamond means that journal which is open access, they are not taking any article processing charges, and whether it there is a license, that license is of CC BY license. What is it means CC BY license? CC BY license means that all the content actually are available at without any restrictions to the reader. So if you are an author of this article that published into the Chitkara University Publications, any journal, so you don't need any requirement to ask the editor or publisher to take your own content, right? So this is free for any kind of restrictions. And it means that all the copyrights goes to the authors, right? So there is no copyright problem, all the copyrights to the authors. And we are using the OJS platform for the publications. And I want to highlight actually some points about to the Chitkara University Publications. As I told you about to the Diamond Open Access Journal, what is it means. And at the second point, we are following the peer review process, especially single blind in all journals. And it may be a point of discussion that why you are using the single blind, why you are not using the double blind, or why you are not using the open peer review process. So that thing is different, but at right now we are using the single blind peer review process in our publications. All copyrights to the authors, as I had mentioned. So it means that we are using the CC BY license, and CC BY license provide all the rights to the author that we mentioned at the end in our research article that we publish. And so number 4 point is that if you are submitting your article in any preprint repository, so we also consider that article for the submission into our journal. At number 5, the plan is compliant journal. Most of the people actually are not aware still about to the Coalition S and that group and their 10 points. The 10 points actually are mentioned into the plan S. If you want to know more about to the plan S, my dear friends, just type this plan S into the Google and you will basically know everything about to it. And there are 10 points. So in general, when I discuss in different presentations, all these points. So if you are attending regularly, so you are aware about it. And the most important thing of Chitkara University publication is that we are the member of the COP, Committee on Publication Ethics. So we are following all the points, right? Wherever we observe that we require some guidance or need some documentation, so we ask to them, and we follow that criteria. And together with it, it is very common that we are providing the digital object identifier to each and every article since the inception of the Chitkara University publication. And article preservation is important in, when we are publishing the article. And together it, we had also discussed about to the Pavlon. So when Professor Poonam Tandon ma'am asking about to it, that how basically we can give the credit to the reviewers. So at this point, actually, Pavlons is a very important platform. Here you can create your own profile. If you are a reviewer, you can provide that information there. Together, if you are taking any editorial role in any journal, you can basically include your, that information onto the Pavlon. So you can basically get the credits of that. And now we are on available on the Pavlon. So if you had review our article anytime, so you can update the information on the Pavlon chart. So, and PlumX is a tool basically of this corpus and Altmetrics for the Web of Science. So what they do basically, they collect the information, how your article basically disseminated into the scientific way and into the social terms, like social media platform. So at the end, open access policy we had defined at the Sherpa Romeo website. So from there, you can find out the manuscript version for different manuscript version policy that we had defined. So here in this slide, you can get some idea about to the Chitkara University publications. So you can see that we had our journals in 2013, that since then we are using the DOI. Then in 2019, as we are growing, so we since then we are the member of the COP. And 2020, we have made our journals according to the Plan S. So now we most of the funding agency basically follow journal checker tool of the Plan S. So we are compliant to the Plan S. Might be you are not aware of many terminology that I am using, but when you will observe as per your own piece, then you will realize it, how basically we are growing. So recently, we are the member of the SDG, United Nations SDG Publisher Compact. And together with that, it's very important information that I want to share with you all, because we are growing very in a very systematic pace. So recently, I had collaborated, we had collaborated actually with the America. America is the UNESCO project. And they are providing us technology, technology in terms that how we have to convert our article into the HTML, how we have to convert our articles into the XML format and into the different version of the, whether that is suitable for the mobile, for the e-publication like that. Right, so these are the most important point. And now in the 2022, we are just going to submit again our some of our journals for the Scopus and Web of Science indexing. So this is our plan for the 2022. And there are many things basically that matters for the public publisher. And we check all those points, whether that is related to the research misconduct, plagiarism, etc. And you can observe, basically, per peer, I am providing this information in a soul. Being a researcher, actually, you should be aware if you are attending my lecture first time and this information. So I just provide just for the information that find out this website and try to find out how the people are actually reviewing the article after the publication. So you don't think that before publication is the review process is going on. After publication also it happens, and Papier is that website where you can see all the information. Retraction works from this website, you can find out that how many articles basically are retracted, and you will get surprised that recently in past year, more than 100 articles retracted related to the COVID-19. Right. So these are some points that I want to share with you all, and I'm thankful to you. And now I hand over to the platform to the Madam Aswarya to introduce our respected speaker. So let's stop.
Thank you so much, sir.
So, Aswarya, hand over to you, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So, well, now coming to today's event, distinguished delegates, participants, and partakers, it's a glorious moment to extend my warm wishes on behalf of Chitkara University for celebrating Peer Review Week 2021. And it gives me tremendous contentment to be presenting the welcome speech amongst the most esteemed personalities who have won accolades in their respective fields. They say, a good editor doesn't rewrite words, he rewires synapses. I am delighted to introduce today's presenter, Mr. Yatindra Joshi. Mr. Yatindra Joshi has been recognized as a diplomat editor by the Board of Editors in the Life Sciences USA for exhibiting exceptional editing skills. He was the first non-European to be elected to the European Association of Science Editors Council. He has also worked at the World Institute of Sustainable Energy in Pune for several years as a freelance editor. Contributed as a scientist at the Indian Council of Agricultural Research for over 10 years. Since 1989, he has been a member of the editorial board of the Information Design Journal in the Netherlands, as well as the Communication Research Institute in Melbourne and the European Association of Science Editors. Well, I want to convey my heartfelt gratitude to Mr. Yatindra Joshi for accepting the invitation and presiding over this webinar on the nitty-gritty of submitting manuscripts to high impact factor journals. Well, the webinar brushes upon a spectrum of exciting and benefiting themes that discuss the aspects of submitting manuscripts to high impact factor journals. On behalf of Chitkara University, I'm compelled to all the research scholars and paper presenters from various parts of country who have made it to the webinar. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Aishwarya, and thank you, Dr. Sukumar, for giving me this opportunity. Now, all the members of the audience, you are giving me the gift of your time, and that is precious. So I must tell you, what I think you will get in return, it's only reasonable that you should get something worth for the time that you are willing to spend. So I have only two clear assurances that if you put into practice what I'm going to share with you, you will succeed on two counts. One is, as I will explain, that when you submit a paper to a journal, and especially to a high impact factor journal, you have to clear two rounds. The first one is a qualifying round or a preliminary round, in which they decide whether your article is worth sending to reviewers in the first place. So my assurance is, if you put into practice what I'm going to share with you, almost always you will clear this first round. The next, you will be judged, your paper will be judged for its scientific content, not so much on its presentation or copy editing and so on. That will have been taken care of in the qualifying round. So once again, if your paper is accepted by the reviewers, maybe with revisions, and when you submit your final version to the journal, then again, if you prepare your paper just the way the journal wants you to, then your paper will move ahead in this assembly line faster than other papers that have also been approved, that are also waiting their turn. But because you have taken the trouble to prepare your paper just the way the journal wants it, you will have an edge over others. So that's That's going to be my theme. So let's see how this works. Let me begin by sharing my screen and we'll see how it goes. If at any point you think that there is a mismatch between what I'm talking, because sometimes it happens in webinars that there is a lag. So I may be advancing slides from my system here, but it takes little time. So in case there is a lag, please alert me. Now, having said that, I should also mention that even if you take every care, even if your subject is worth, if your research contribution is substantial, you have prepared your paper the way the journal wants it, is faultless in terms of spelling, grammar, composition, and so on, even then at times it can be rejected because it is a matter of chance. Not everything, but yes, it can happen. So I often think of this as a game of snakes and ladders. For instance, now what's a snake here? Let's say that your paper lands on the reviewer's desk when the reviewer, for some other totally unrelated reasons, is in a bad mood, and that reflects in her or his assessment of your paper. So that's a big snake. On the other hand, maybe that your paper arrives at the editor's desk at the very moment when they are looking especially for papers on the topic, and your paper happens to be on the same topic on which they are actively on the lookout. So that's, I would say, is a ladder. But overall, as I said, by preparing your paper carefully, we will increase the chances that you will encounter more ladders than snakes. And that journey begins from choosing the right journal, because very often papers are rejected without review simply because they don't fall within the scope of the journal. So it is vitally important to find the right home for your paper. So how do you go about it? Now, there are several ways. For instance, you could use Google Scholar. Now, here I'm assuming that your manuscript is practically ready. There may be some finishing touches. I'll come to that later. But I am assuming that your manuscript is written up. You have a title finalized. You have an abstract and so on. So what I suggest is you copy the title of your paper, title of your manuscript. It's not a paper yet. You copy the title of your manuscript and paste it in Google Scholar's search box. And you watch the results for which journals occur more frequently in that list. The assumption being that since the search is based on the title of your own manuscript and these journals seem to be featuring more often in that list, it is likely that there will be a good match between what you have to offer and what the journal wants. So that is one way. Another trick that you should do is look at the references that you have appended at the end of your manuscript under references. And then again, see which journals feature more frequently in that list. So that should also give you a clue that because you are citing works published by those journals, again, we can assume that there is a good match between your manuscript and the journal's requirements. On the other hand, if you don't find that your target journal, the journal to which you intend to submit your manuscript, does not feature even once in that list of references, I would say there is something amiss. You know, either your choice of the journal is not right, or maybe your literature search leaves something to be desired. So be on the lookout for this, that your target journal should feature ideally amongst the list of references that you have appended. Now, in addition to these two steps, you can also be a little more systematic and use some web-based services. For instance, there is Web of Science. Now, essentially, all these web-based services operate the same way. What you do is you paste the title of your paper in the window that's provided. You paste the abstract of your paper in another window that's provided. And then you click select journal or recommend journal or whatever. Then the web page runs some kind of algorithm and tries to match the contents that you have provided by way of title and abstract with whatever algorithm or database it has, and it comes up with a recommendation of a few journals. Now, in Manuscript Matcher, because it is operated by the Web of Science, it will recommend only those journals that are part of the Web of Science. Whereas if it's a requirement that you want to publish your paper only in Open Access Journal, then you could use Open Journal Matcher. It works exactly the same way. You provide the title and the abstract, and it will return with list of journals, in this case only open access journals, that according to the algorithm has a good fit with what you have to offer. The different publishers, now you see the whole game of science publishing is dominated by a few big names: Elsevier, Springer, Wiley, Taylor and Francis. So these publishers also have similar web pages. The only condition being, of course, that if you, for instance, go to Springer's website, then it will recommend only those journals that are published by Springer or Elsevier or Wiley, depending on the website. So you can use any of these means, or preferably a combination of these means, to find your target journal. But that is only half of your homework. Once you choose a journal, you need to do two things. You need to study its instruction to authors with great attention, because you must follow all these instruction to authors. In papers that I copy edit, I often ask my authors, first, you along with your paper, you tell me which journal you intend to submit your paper to. So I can go up, look at the journal's website, study its instruction to authors. Now, very often I find that this is something that authors overlook. Understandably so, because these instruction to authors have nothing to do with the subject content. It has everything to do with the way the journal wants you to prepare your manuscript, but do not neglect this step. Especially if you are talking of submitting papers to high impact factor journals, which also have very high rejection rates, then you are in tough competition. Now, publishers of those journals are simply looking for ways to say no as effortlessly as possible. And if they find that you have violated the journal's instruction to authors, they don't even need to read the contents. All they need to see is that you have not followed the instruction to authors. So they will say, sorry, but we can't accept your paper. So we should not give them that chance. So we should study the instruction to authors, supplement that study by examining a recent issue of the journal. Now, you are subject matter specialist, you follow journals in your field, and when you look at the journals, obviously your focus is on the contents. But when I ask you to examine a recent issue of the journal with the intent to submit your paper to that journal, that examination is rather different. It has nothing to do with the substance or the contents. It has everything to do with the presentation of the article. And I will touch upon this as we go along. So as I said, you could use Google Scholar, paste the title in the search box. You could use Manuscript Matcher by Web of Science. You could use Open Journal Matcher. Wiley has, for instance, Journal Finder. So you could do that. Springer has Journal Suggester. These are different names, but they all work the same way. Springer Journal Suggester, Elsevier Journal Finder. They all work the same way. Now, when you submit your paper to a journal, as I said, there are very common grounds why manuscripts are rejected. So we'll take a look at that. There are 7 most common reasons why manuscripts are rejected by journals. The first four are focused on the substance of your paper, on your research. And I cannot assume any expertise on that. You know, I can't be presumptuous. So I will say that this is beyond the scope of this webinar. But besides these 4 reasons, there are 3 other reasons which are important and which are very much within our control, which have very little to do with the substance, but it has everything to do with the care that you lavish on preparing your paper to match the journal's requirements. So these are reasons, and you must focus on these as well. You should also realize that getting a paper published is a long drawn out process. It's a marathon. It's not a sprint event. It takes anywhere between 6 months to 2 years. And why does it take so long? Because it has to pass through 7 steps, which begin by your sending or uploading a manuscript. Then there is a preliminary screening or a qualifying round. As I said, this is mainly to decide whether your paper is worth being sent out for a review. If you clear this round, then your paper is sent to reviewers. Reviewers are referees, they're synonyms. Then they would come back to you, or rather they would come back to the editor, and the editor in turn will relay the comments to your author. At this stage, the reviewers may say that, look, we have examined your contribution, and we are sorry, but we cannot recommend it. That is one possible outcome. Don't lose heart. There is always another journal. Or they might say that, look, we have some concerns. These are our comments. So we would suggest that you revise your manuscript in the light of these comments. So your job in this case is to convince the editor of the journal that you have addressed every concern expressed by the reviewers. Mark my words, it doesn't mean that you have to necessarily agree to everything what the reviewers are saying. You may beg to differ, but so long as you offer adequate justification for turning down the reviewer's comments or request, then the journal editor will be with you. So you must convince the journal's editor that you have revised the manuscript as required by the referees. You have addressed every concern that they had. So you publish, submit a revised version. Then that is typeset, copy edited, made into pages. You get a chance to correct the proofs should there be any errors in this process, and your paper is published. So this is a long drawn out process. You can't hurry it up. But what you can do is you should go in for parallel processing. What do I mean by parallel processing? That at any time, if you are a researcher, you are an academic, at any stage in your career, you should have several manuscripts at different stages of the seven steps that I just outlined. So don't wait until all your research is complete, then you write the paper, then you submit it. Once it is published, then you start working on your next paper. No, that is not how you should play this game. At any point, you should have several papers. Maybe there is one paper that you had submitted quite some time back and you are now only correcting the proof. So you are almost near the finishing line. So all you need to do is send the corrected proofs and your paper is going to be published. Then there will be another manuscript which you have revised in the light of the comments made by the reviewer, and you are about to submit the revised version to the journal. So that could be your second paper. Then there could be a third paper which has just been reviewed and you have heard from the journal and you are going through the reviewer's comments and you are thinking how best to address them. That's your third paper. Maybe there's a fourth paper which you are putting finishing touches to, and I'll come back later to what I mean by finishing touches, and that you're about to submit to a journal. Then there should be a fifth paper that you are actually writing at the moment, and so on. So that is how you should play this game. And as I said, start writing early, especially take the method section. Why wait until the results are out to write the method section? Method section should be written concurrently as your research work continues. That way you will have all the details fresh in your memory. You can refer to any detail that is missing. So method section, result section, you should write as you get information. Don't wait until the last moment. And don't keep on waiting indefinitely. I would say 6 to 8 weeks is a reasonable time. If you don't hear from the journal's editor, you should send a polite reminder. Do not be under the impression that the journal editor will be annoyed or this will be held against you. No. So long as you do it politely and within a reasonable time, absolutely, there is no reason, because after all, it's your work. You have put in almost all the effort. So you have a right to know what is happening to your paper. One additional tip is that all other things being equal, and what I mean by other things being like impact factor, the rejection rate or the acceptance rate, the time for processing, other things being equal, I would suggest that you should go in for journals that are published more frequently, once a week, once 2 weeks, once a month. Why? Because these journals have a more robust processing, whereas journals that are published less frequently, maybe one or two or three, 4 times a year, they tend to be a little slack, by and large. So you are better served by journals that are published more frequently because they have all the processes that are streamlined. So do that. Now, as I said, this is the qualifying round. These are the things that are checked. And as before, there are factors that are beyond the scope of this webinar. These, whether it fits in with the journal scope, whether it's sufficiently novel and so on, that has to do with the substance of your research. But there is one other factor, and that refers to appropriate formatting. Now, these are again matters of trivial details that have nothing to do with your research. So you can be excused for being annoyed or irritated by the journals insistent on these trivial formalities. But remember, you are in competition. You want to get your paper published in high impact factor journal. So it will pay you to format it exactly the way the journal wants it. And journals can be picky about this. For instance, this is a warning given by a journal from Canada that if you don't meet these standards, if you don't follow our style, sorry, but we will not be able to even send your manuscript out for review. There's another editor-in-chief who comes up with this clear warning that you must follow the guidelines for submission given by the journal. That's important. So you should make every effort to succeed in this game. You must beat your competition. You must put your best foot forward. It's like when you appear for a job, when you go for the interview, in addition to ascertaining yourself that you fit, you meet the requirements, even then you will take care about your personal appearance. You will wear well-pressed clothes. You will polish your shoes. Why? Now, why should they matter? But nevertheless, you do that because you want to give a good first impression. The same thing applies to getting your paper published. So you should have a cover letter. Now, don't make the mistake of copying the abstract of your paper and pasting it into the covering letter. No, that is not how you write a cover letter. The first thing you should do is to find out who exactly you should address your letter to. As far as possible, address it by name. Don't say, dear editor, that's only as a last resort. There are two other things that you must mention in your cover letter so far as it's possible. One is if you can establish a link between your paper, between your manuscript and what the journal has already published maybe in the past couple of years. If you mention specific articles which connect to your paper, that's a point in your favor. So if you can establish such a connection, by all means, mention it in the covering letter. The second thing you must mention in two or three lines is what is the exact gap in knowledge that your contribution seeks to fill, or what is the precise problem to which your paper offers a solution. So these two things must make a part of your cover letter. In addition to that, you could also add something about why you have chosen this particular journal to submit your paper to. Then there could be other things like category of submission, because journals publish full-length research papers, they publish research communications, they publish letters to the editor, case studies, whatever. So if you are submitting under a particular category, then you should mention that. Now the title and abstract of your paper and the first paragraphs of introduction discussion, you must put even extra effort to prepare this carefully, because these are the areas, because at preliminary screening, nobody is going to read the full paper. They are only getting an idea of whether it should go out for a review. So they will skim through all this. And there you should not make simple errors of spelling, grammar, punctuation, and so on. You should format your references just the way the journal wants it. For instance, now here I've given you some examples. Simple errors of grammar that might prejudice the editor against you. Now, see the proposed work extract features. Now, proposed work is singular. So it cannot take a plural verb extracts, and then a preposition is missing. Proposed work extracts features from 14 channels. That's my understanding. Likewise, use of articles. Now, the kitchen waste. No, it's not the kitchen waste. It's just kitchen waste. And although I'm not very sure how to revise it, because I was a little puzzled about this remains. So what it really meant, but it may the author meant it needs to be managed effectively. So you see, these are things that need to be avoided. Simple errors of spelling, grammar, punctuation, and so on. So here, instead of is, it should have been as a wheelchair, as a chair with wheels, whatever. Now, even if your paper is rejected by the journal, don't give up. As these statistics will tell you, almost 2/3 of the papers that were once rejected were published subsequently. All you need to do is you cannot submit the same paper simultaneously to multiple journals. You must do it sequentially. So submit it a paper to a journal. If it's rejected, only then submit it to another journal. And even Nobel Prize winners have had their papers rejected. There's an interesting article on this. As you could see, that papers that were later on highly cited were initially rejected. So with this background, we'll come to the body of the paper itself. We start with the title. Now you must spend enough time to get the right title. Again, the best guide is your target journal. Some journals like long titles, some journals prefer short titles. Some journals encourage complete sentences as titles. Some journals discourage complete sentences as titles. So examine your target journal and see what kind of titles it publishes. Your aim should be to come up with an indicative title, which will accurately signal what you have to offer. The first word of your title, don't let that first word be a vague word such as a study or an experiment or investigation. It should be a key term depending on your topic. The first word is important. How long the title should be? Well, somebody came up with this idea of 10 plus or minus 3 words based on a study. I will cite that. Now, after having done all this, you should still check the title. You should prepare your title in terms of its presentation. Things like capitalization, alignment, weight, all these are trivial, but they matter. For instance, see this. Now, this is a simple, plain title. Elsevier typically uses this. So there is no extra capital words. It is left aligned. Nothing is bold. Whereas in this case, it is again as above, but it is bold. It is still makes sparse use of capital letters. It is still left aligned, but it is bold. Whereas in this case, it is all this, but it is not left aligned, but it is centered. There's no one right or wrong way about this. It's simply the journal's preference. So here, whereas you see the case has changed. The first three examples are what we call sentence case. That is, only the essential words are proper nouns are capitalized, whereas a title case is every significant word is capitalized. So some journals follow that. Within that, again, a title case could be left aligned, could be centered, could be right aligned. There is no rhyme or reason for this. Some journals will print the entire titles in capital letters. So the idea is to examine your target journal and print your title accordingly. Remember that. Next comes the abstract. Important thing to remember is do not repeat in the body of the abstract the information that can be given by the title. It's a very common error. Don't do that. I will show you examples. Likewise, abstract, you don't need background information. You don't need to list objectives. Once you list your results, people can make out what your objectives must have been. And background information is part of the introduction. It is not part of the abstract. Likewise, make the abstract as freestanding on its own. So generally avoid abbreviations, keep it within the word limits. Now here's an example. This is the title of a paper. And you see how the abstract begins. I mean, it's not adding anything by way of information. So avoid that. Keywords, again, the choice of keywords. So this is a title and this is how the abstract begins. These are not examples that you should follow. Likewise, background information. Now here's a title, it's about fitness level. But if you see the abstract, only after many lines, the authors are coming to the point. So this study was aimed at whatever. No, abstract, you should come to the point straight away. For instance, if this is a title, so only after a few lines, this paper provides a holistic view. So these are bad examples. And always remember that title and abstract work together. This is an extreme example of this. It's paper from Journal of Physics. So I'm sure Dr. Sushil Kumar will have extra interest in this. This is a long title, but abstract is only two words. This is an extreme example, of course, but I'm making the point that the title and abstract always go together. Sometimes even two words is one too many. Take another example. Again, a longish title framed as a question with one word abstract. These are all published papers. These are, of course, extreme examples, but just to drive home my point. Then you have to use keywords. Just as I said that you should not repeat in the body of the abstract what you are saying in the title. The words that you have already used in the title are not good keywords. Why? Because those words which occur in the title of your paper are going to be indexed automatically. Keywords is your chance to submit more terms, maybe synonyms, maybe more specific terms, so that your paper can be retrieved by people who are looking for information on that topic. So typically, terms that are too broad, and keyword doesn't mean it's one word. Typically, in fact, it should be two or three words because that will be more specific. And after you have chosen this, just as you did for titles, pay attention to how keywords are presented by the journal. Some journals consider keywords as two separate words. Some journals consider it as one word. Some journals arrange them alphabetically. Some arrange them by importance. Some use title case. Some use sentence case. Some separate them by commas. Some separate it by semicolons, whatever. So here's an example that this is the title, and you see these are the keywords. Now, they are not really effective keywords because either they are repeating what is already said in the title or they are too broad. Now, can you imagine if you are, let's say, if your Google's search is open in front of you and you type the word quality, will you ever do that? Most unlikely. If you just type quality in Google search box, you will get millions of results. Another example, the same thing, why repeat them? You are only losing a good opportunity. Cluster analysis is the only term that is added, otherwise it's the same old terms that are already there in the title, so avoid that. They shouldn't be too broad either. Now imagine collisions, season. Now season, it can't be a good keyword. So don't consider keywords as just a formality. It is your chance to get your paper noticed by many more people. So whereas these are good examples, you see, this is the title and you could see there are not one word, but two words, specific terms. These are good choice of keywords. Likewise, avoid keywords that are abbreviations. Now, AQI, for instance, now you may think that it means air quality index, but it could mean something else also. So avoid, in general, abbreviations don't make good keywords. So that's the keywords. Now we'll come to the body of the paper itself. IMRAD structure is what is followed by most journals. Introduction, methods, results, and discussion. Each of this is an answer to a question. Now, when you sit down to write a paper, don't bother about this, because this is not a good description of your task. Don't say to yourself that I'm going to write a research paper. Say to yourself that I'm going to present an account of my research in about 25 to 30 paragraphs, structured as follows. So this is a broad framework that you must use. It is not cast in stone. You can vary it, but by and large, this is what was found based on analyzing thousands of papers. So this is your framework. And as I said, you can approach it not in the same sequence. Methods and results, you can start writing even earlier. So that is your task. This is the paper if you want to read how these numbers were arrived at. So now let us quickly run through the IMRAD section. Introduction. Introduction answers the question why. As I said, each is an answer to a question. So introduction, you should state the problem, give some numbers to justify that the problem is important, that it deserves a solution. Quickly review how others have approached the problem, because you see, unlike a thesis or a dissertation, there is no chapter or there is no heading in a research paper called review of literature. It is part of the introduction. So you should briefly review how others have approached the problem and specify what is different about your paper. So that's part of the introduction. So you must stress what is unique to your paper? And typically an introduction is like a funnel. It starts broad at the top and you keep narrowing it down until you end the introduction with a statement of the specific objectives that you sought to achieve. That should be your introduction. Then methods answers a different question. How? Now, okay, we know why, you tell us how. So all the details that people will require if they want to repeat the experiment, you must provide them. It's not secret. In fact, that is how science progresses. This is your guarantee of truth that, look, this is what I did. This is what I found. You can do your own experiment and corroborate or contrast my finding. So all these details, depending on the topic of your research, if a season is critical, the kind of equipment that you use, for instance, let's say you used an electron microscope, but what make was that? Was it Hitachi? Was it Olympus? What was the name of the model? Use atomic absorption spectrophotometer. What company? What make? So all that you must specify. Any statistical tests that you use, did you go in for analysis of variance? Did you use chi-square? Did you use student's t-test? How did you arrive at the sample? That's also important. Whether you followed standard methods, you modified them. Did you receive anything free? What was your control? That's important because that's the comparison, your control and treatment. So your method section must spell out this explicitly. In terms of writing, just stick to the past tense because this is something that has already happened. It's in the past. So stick to the past tense. So that's method section. Then the result section, third question, what? So we know why, we know how. Tell us, what did you find? So this is the objective part of your paper. There'll be tables, there'll be charts. Now, you don't start explaining your results in the result section. That is the job of the discussion section. So you could use tables, you could use charts, but you cannot use the same data once as a chart and once as a table. Make up your mind and use that. Now, if you have done statistical analysis and you don't find significant differences, there's no point in discussing them because where they are not significant means that could happen by chance. You must follow exact conventions in expressing units. I'll come to that in a minute. You can use supplementary tables. And here again, you should use the past tense because you are reporting what you found. So here's a bit of digression that, for instance, be precise in your measurement, but not over precise. Now, this is an example you could see. It says height above mean sea level, 15.035. First of all, unit itself is missing. That you should never do. You must mention the units. Even if here you can supply the units through common sense that, well, it is going to be meters, but it is expressed to 3 decimal points. Now, there is no way the height could have been measured to that level of precision. So always express your figures only to that level, which is consistent with the measuring device that you have used. If you are using multi-digit figures, now remember that you are submitting your paper to typically a foreign journal, which doesn't use lakhs and crores. So you should know how to present these numbers because the grouping is different. It is thousands, millions, billions, trillions, and so on, not lakhs and crores. So you see this 6-digit figure will be read as 123,456, not 1,23,000. Whether you use a comma or a space, that's a matter of style. But see, that is done correctly here. 13,616,593,585,727. That's correct, not in this way. Then if you are talking about a decrease, don't use times because times use means multiplication. Now you can't say something is 5 times less. Now, what is 5 times less? You could say 1/5. You can say 20%. Now, is this a reduction? 201.83% reduction. What does it mean? You can figure it out for yourself. So you could say that the yield was about a third or decreased by 66%, whatever. Now, remember that SI units are symbols. They are not abbreviations. They do not have plural forms. Don't ever write 2 kgs. No. whether it's 2, whether it's 5, whether it's 50, it is still kg, not kgs. Nor should you put a dot unless it comes at the end of the sentence. When you spell it out in full, it takes lowercase, where the symbol may be capital, may be lowercase. Correct symbol, degree sign, how often I correct this in the manuscript that I edit. Degree sign, you don't get it by typing a 0 and making it a superscript, or typing O and making it a superscript. There is a proper degree symbol, perfectly round circle, that is what you should use. You don't type X, capital or lowercase, no. There's a proper multiplication symbol. There is a proper micro, all that you must observe. If you don't know how to do this, if you are using Windows, you know, go to character map. It will show you all symbols that are accessible to you depending on the font that you have chosen. There are keystrokes, so you can use that coding also. Now, you should not allow the quantity to be separated from its unit. No, this is not acceptable. They must occur together. 8.01 cannot be separated from centimeters. So keep them together. Anyway, it's a needless precision. So keep that in mind. Now, between is always followed by and. From is always followed by to. You can't mix and match. If it's between, it has to be and. If it's from, it has to be to. If you are expressing a range of percentage, this percent sign needs to be repeated. 2% to 5%. Multiplication sign, not letter X. Minus sign, not hyphen. See, raised to the minus 3 means it's minus sign. This is a hyphen. This is a lowercase x. So keep that in mind. Follow proper minus sign, hyphens. When you explain an abbreviation, you don't have to use capital letters for the nouns. They should remain lowercase letters, as is done here. Not like this. Falling with cap F, weight with cap W, D, cap D, no. Should be lowercase. So that was a brief digression. Now discussion answers the most important question. So what? What do these numbers mean? So that is where you need to explain your results. That is where you need to make good the promise that you made at the end of your introduction. Now you said that this is what I set out to find. So you must do that. Now, you should not use words such as interesting or remarkable. That is up to the readers to do it. And you will need a mix of tenses when you write the discussion section. Unlike methods or results where you could stick to the simple past, discussion requires a mix of tenses. So that's about the body of the paper. Then we have citations and references. Citations could be by numbers, so journals. Publishers often refer to it as Vancouver system or the Harvard system. So Harvard system is names of authors and the year of publication. So within that also there are minor variations, whether italics printed as italics or not. But remember, there is no dot after ET. ET in Latin means and. Do not make the mistake of thinking that it's an abbreviation. It is not. Now some journals will put a comma here. Some journals will put a space. How do you arrange multiple citations? For instance, should they be in chronological order to 2001, then 2, then 4, then 5? Or should they be in reverse chronological order, 7, then 5, 4, 2? Or could they be alphabetical? Different journals follow different methods. So observe your target journal and follow that system. Now, Vancouver system also has trivial differences. Even such a thing as, you know, you can note here, Elsevier abbreviates journal titles, puts a dot. Springer abbreviates but does not put a dot. Wiley spells out the journal title in full and puts a volume number in bold. Taylor and Francis does the same, but volume number is in italics. So minor differences. What you could do is you could use Google Scholar to format the reference. Locate the reference you want to cite. Click on the icon for quotation. And Google Scholar will cite it in different ways. Then you can cut and paste. You can do that. Now the finishing touches that I spoke to you about. This is where you observe the journal and follow that style. But journals may be printed in multiple column, but you should submit only a single column. Journals may be followed in full justification, you should follow left justification. Whatever font journal uses, you should use, I would strongly recommend Georgia or Sitka rather than Times New Roman, because they are so much easier to read on the screen. Now, journals differ. Some journals spell out the word figure in full. Some journals abbreviate it. So you should follow whatever the journal style. Some use numbered headings with a dot after numbers. Some journals will use numbered heading without a dot. Some journals will not use numbers at all. Lastly, predatory journals. Do not submit your papers to predatory journal. One simple way to spot a predatory journal is if the journal's website displays its ISSN very prominently, it is always a suspect journal. Second sign, if you get an email from a journal sending, asking you to submit your papers to that journal, that is also a warning sign. Don't fall prey to these journals. For instance, this is the schedule that these journals promise. Now you know that it is absurd. If you follow all these 7 steps, you can't possibly do that. UGC has taken a tough stand on this. If you publish in predatory journals, that's a disgrace for you as well as your institute. So refrain from doing it. For instance, take an example. Now this is a journal that calls itself European Journal of Nutrition. But when I visited the website, it showed the price in addition to dollars in Indian rupees. Why? If it's a European journal, why is it asking in dollars? And why is it saying Indian rupees? Something is amiss. And see, if it's European Journal of Nutrition and Food Safety, why is this address, a residential address in Kolkata? So dig deeper. So I want to end this with a suggestion on resources. Many publishers offer good advice on all aspects of publishing. So Taylor & Francis has extensive website on all these steps. Springer has a Springer Academy. Elsevier has its research academy. It gives you advice on writing skills, technical writing, writing a book. Editage offers lots of information on how to write a research paper. Wiley has his author services. Lastly, I want to show you some useful books. You can read them. You can get your library to get them. These are good books. After all, hundreds of books, I have selected those that are most useful. And I have given you the bibliographic details of these books. So if your library wants to order them, that's fine. These are all good, useful books. So I want to end with my key takeaways. Choose the right journal. Don't choose the wrong journal. Don't use predatory journal. Follow instruction to authors meticulously. Put finishing touches, run a spell check. So thank you very much. I would be happy to share this presentation in PDF. If you write to me, I'll be glad to share this. I'll stop sharing here. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them.
Yes, thank you so much, sir. And now we are open for the audience. If audience have any question or any doubt, so they are free to ask. Just raise your hand or type the question in chat box. Right. Someone is asking, raise the hand. Mm-hmm. Kuldeep Singh, sir.
Yes, Dr. Kuldeep, what's the question?
Dr. Kuldeep Singh? Mm-hmm. Okay, one thing we can discuss since then the audience or participants raise the and or ask the question. You just pointed to very important thing, pointed out very important thing that was related to the keywords. Mm-hmm. It is very true that if you will, let me ask, sir, someone is, I think, if an article has been published in 1957 and republished in 2007, then which year is to be cited in our research article?
57, 1957, no question. Any other questions you may have? In any case, I've shared my email ID. If you have some questions even later, I'll be happy to answer them.
Yes. Most of the time it happens that immediately question doesn't come.
Yes, yes, so, I understand that.
I was asking one thing related to the keywords, sir, that it is very important that single keyword is not sufficient at the right time. And Google Scholar or academic search engines are the most suitable tools, I can say, that can provide the exact information to the researchers. So one has to use the phrases of the keywords.
Yes, typically combinations of two words or three words, because that will be more specific.
So the purpose to Google Scholar is that when one search anything on the Google, so most of the time scholarly articles opens and the main source remain the Google Scholar and some journals website. But if you type any keyword into the Google and scholarly article opens, that means that is the relevant keyword of your research article, instead of using the random, as you had mentioned, some using season. There is no meaning of the season or like that. Right. So now we have to be very careful when we are using the keywords. So it is very important that either you check, use the professional tool or otherwise use the Google Scholar and academic search engines. If you are not aware about to the academic search engine, just type, you will get. So type your keyword and find out the relevant response of the Google Scholar. They are providing you the scholarly articles or not. If not, then modify your keyword. And one more thing, sir. So you just mentioned, because I had focused on the keywords only, you had mentioned that when you are using the keyword in title, then there is no requirement to write into the keywords.
Yes, you should not repeat, because the terms that you have used in the title will be indexed automatically. Okay. You can use the synonyms, for instance, or you could use more specific phrases that you cannot put in the title. That is what you should use as keywords, because you must make your paper findable.
One more question, sir, in the chat box.
Sure.
Nowadays, when we send paper for publications, reviewers ask to cite key papers of their. Is it ethical?
No.
Actually, this kind of practice. Yes, sir. Please.
Yeah, no, I understand, because after all, the reviewers want to increase their H index. Yes. So I would say that, you should also be pragmatic. Now, if you want to cite a paper by the reviewer, and if it is relevant, even peripherally relevant, I would say play the game, cite it. After, you don't lose anything. But if it's totally irrelevant, then you should excuse yourself. Then you are not being honest. But if it's the chance that you can comply with the request, it costs you nothing. It doesn't detract from the quality of your paper. Let the reviewer be happy. Take the pragmatic approach.
This kind of practice, actually, I feel earlier, 7-8 years before, this type of practice was much more when the reviewer basically send into the comment box that you have to use these references in your.
Yes.
But nowadays,
even journals editors do that, because they want to increase the impact factor of their journal.
Yeah. That is again actually for the citation. So as you mentioned, that if it is relevant to your article, you should mention that. You should not be very strict that you know.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes.
But it is, we are actually open, and you can ask the question or type the question, or I will, sir, also mention the email ID, so you can directly ask the question, or you can request anything or you can a problem in your research article. So if there is no question or no other point, so I can say thank you to each and everyone who has joined and give us time for all this fruitful discussion. And I'm sure that the information shared by the Sir Yatindra Joshi sir will benefit to each and every researcher. So thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Pleasure.
For the audience. Thank you so much.
Bye.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks to all of you. And now we are planning for the tomorrow presentation. So that presentation will be at the same time. And there's a professor, Professor Gregory Prague from the Western University, Sydney, Australia. And he will discuss many more points because he is chief editor of different journals. And at the same time, dean of the his department. So personally, I feel that the variety into the presentation will help you to inculcate some more information in your research activity. And really, I'm thankful to your time and your presence in this schedule. This was the peer review week, right? And my purpose is just to share the information to make aware the scientific community this kind of platform, actually where world is talking about to it. If you will type peer review week into Google searches, you will find many more information about to it. And being a researcher, being an academician, you basically must be related to all these things. So thank you once again for your time and your connection and all these things there.